Yo, welcome back to The Breakfast on Plots TV Africa. It's now time for our second big conversation, and it's about Nnamdi Kanu. He was arrested allegedly on Sunday, June 27th, 2021. And, you know, all the dynamics of the case seems to be changing because the UK government, you know, has gotten involved, and we're basically discussing Nnamdi Kanu and the Nigerian state. Mr. Tunde Kolawole, public affairs analyst, joins us now to talk about this. Good morning, Mr. Kolawole.
Good morning, my sister.
Let's first get where you stand regarding the arrest of Nnamdi Kanu. Many people are saying this is, especially IPOB leaders, that this is basically a kidnap and not an extradition.
Yes, absolutely. I agree that this is a kidnapping. And it wouldn't be the first time we're having it in this country, especially under President Muhammad Buhari. You will remember that when he was military head of state between 1983 and 1985, he similarly dispatched the Nigerian Security Organization and the Israeli Mossad to go and kidnap Alhaji Umar Rudiku in the United Kingdom in London and bring him forcefully back to Nigeria. Alhaji Umar Rudiku was wrestled down. He was injected with some sleeping substances, put in a crate, and was about to be shipped to Nigeria. Luckily for Alhaji Umar Rudiku, his neighbor saw what happened when he was kidnapped, and then they alerted the British police. And those were sealed up their airport, their seaport, and all the land borders. And they found Alhaji Umar Rudiku in a crate where he was going to be put on board the ship on the way to Nigeria. So this, what has happened to Nnamdi Kanu, is similar to that. If Nigeria has issues with Nnamdi Kanu, and Nnamdi Kanu is resident in the UK, what Nigeria ought to have done is to lodge a complaint with the British Home Office or the External Affairs Ministry in Britain, and then they will apply for an extradition of Nnamdi Kanu back to Nigeria. But the fact that they didn't do that makes this one look like a kidnapping. And when you also look at where we are told India has been cutting, which is Kenya, I'm not too sure that Nigeria has an extradition treaty with Kenya. So this must be something that has been done outside the context of the law.
Okay. So is this part of the conversation important with his trial? Is it going to play any role whatsoever with the trial?
The trial?
Yes, when it resumes on the 26th of July, will the part where, of course, you know, you've mentioned that he may not have been brought back to the country legally, is that going to play any, be of any importance?
Before I talk about the trial, let me quickly state that I think it was on your, it might not be on your television station. I have said it before on some other stations that I do hope that Nnamdi Kanu does not make the kind of mistake that Odumeku Ojukwu made when he was leading the agitation for Biafra. Here is a Nnamdi Kanu who is leading a revolutionary struggle and doesn't appear to be prepared, so to say, or has never done what is expected of him. He ought to have known that Nigerian authorities were tracking him, and that they were going to do whatever was necessary to ensure that he was brought back to Nigeria. So he ought to have arranged a tight security around himself. He had to have sought the assistance of the British authorities, the British government, to provide protection for himself. You remember the case of Salman Rushdie, when Salman Rushdie wrote a book, and then the Iranian authorities and all that pronounced a fatwa on a rush trip. And the British authority has to take responsibility to provide protection for rush trip. And the American authorities, I think it's in the U.S. now, the American authorities are the ones providing security for him. So man cannot have made similar arrangements. Furthermore, if you are a liberation fighter, you ought to have made your own security arrangement so that wherever you are going, you will always be protected by your own security guard. So that what happened to him in Kenya, where he was intercepted and come back to Nigeria, could not easily have happened. Furthermore, I have never supported Nnamdi Kanu in Nigeria for whatever sole reason. If you are leading a bishop circle, you are supposed to stay with your people and lead them through the thick and thin of that struggle. In fact, my take is that you have to be in military fatigue with the ESN in the bush, in the bunker, leading the struggle personally and occasionally participating in whatever skirmishes or fights that those people are engaged in with the authorities, and not to go and hibernate in Britain and be leading the struggle on Facebook, on Twitter, and what have you. You know the antecedents of most of the revolutionary fighters. Mandela didn't run away from the people when he was leading the struggle. Kenneth Kaunda never left the country when he was leading the struggle. Even Mr. Benny, who is president in Uganda now, didn't leave his people when he was leading them in the struggle. So it is not proper for Nnamdi Kanu to have left Nigeria to be coordinating the struggle for independence in far away from the city. He also been the thick and thin of the struggle himself.
Okay.
With regards to the trial, there's going to be a lot of challenges in there if the authorities are going to follow the rules and the letters of the law. What is a British citizen? And if you are going to be trying a British citizen in Nigeria for trying to overthrow the government or for carrying out a secession, I mean, leading a secessionist struggle in Nigeria, or if you accuse a foreigner of treasonable felony, there are so many hurdles that you have to cross to be able to grant the conviction, because as of today we are told, Nnamdi Kanu is still carrying the British passport. Furthermore, you would also need proof. The fact that Nnamdi Kanu has been making noise on Twitter, on Facebook, and some of these other social media, it might not be enough to grant the conviction. You must be able to ascertain and put the fact on the ground, concrete evidence that he actually initiated some of those egregious allegations that they have brought against him. More importantly, leading a secession is always talk for or call for an independence shouldn't be a crime under the law. The United Nations Charter recognizes the right of people to speak self-determination. The African Charter equally recognizes it. The African Charter recognizes it. The Nigerian Constitution itself makes provisions for freedom of association and opinion. If the Igbo people feel they are no longer comfortable within the Nigerian nation, what the Nigerian country ought to have done is to organize a referendum to determine whether that call for secession is popular among the Igbo people.
Mr. Kolawole, yes, that leads to my next point. You know, other legal practitioners have argued that there is no provision for a referendum in Nigeria, and that until there's a constitution amendment to include calls and provisions for a referendum, any agitation or secession for a separate state is illegal. Where do you stand regarding that?
That is the gross misunderstanding of the law. A gross misunderstanding of the law. The law provides for freedom of association and opinion. If you have a situation in which certain parts of the country are agitating that they no longer want to be part and parcel of Nigeria, all that the executive is required to do is to take a bill to the National Assembly and say, look, we want to conduct a referendum to determine whether the call for secession or independence of Biafra is popular among the Igbo people. That can be done. The president can also sign an executive order saying that in view of what is happening, or because of the force majeure, matter is an extraordinary occurrence in the environment. And there's also the doctrine of necessity. With all those provisions under our law, a referendum can be easily done without any constitutional provision. You don't need to put it in the constitution before you organize the referendum.
Mr. Kolawole, my question is, in the absence of these provisions to call for a referendum, these executive orders, in the absence of these provisions, the calls for a separate Biafran state, is it legal or not?
Hello? Can you repeat that question, please?
You just mentioned, you know, the circumstances, you know, within which a referendum can take place. So I am saying, yes, in the absence of all that, with our current constitution, the way Nigeria is currently run, is it legal for Nnamdi Kanu to be advocating for a separate Biafran state?
Oh, absolutely.
It's legal.
I have told you that when you look at the United Nations Charter, it provides for a right of self-determination for people to exercise for independence from whatever countries that they have been part and parcel of. And we have seen that being done in the different parts of the country. Look at a country like India. India broke into about three. Pakistan broke away, and I think Indonesia also broke away. And there's another country that also, I think, Singapore also broke away from India after they got their independence. So if that is the case, you also go down to Africa, go and look at the African Charter on people as people's side. It makes provisions for self-determination of people. The Equal Charter also makes provisions for it. And even under the Nigerian Constitution, can say, freedom of association is not just about politics. It's not just about politics. Freedom to hold opinion is not just about politics. Freedom of association includes the right of people to say, look, we are being maltreated within the Nigerian policy, and we want to transform, we want to be independent, we want a separate nation
for
ourselves.
All right, Mr. Kolawole.
There is nothing special, anything wrong with what Nnamdi Kanu is fighting for.
Mr. Kolawole, I want you to speak on the calls for a fair trial and, of course, the importance that the Nigerian government does grant him a fair trial. If you look back at where we're coming from before he jumped bail, the number of times that there were court rulings granting him bail that were, of course, ignored. What, you know, would you expect this time around? Do you have any assurances or trust that the Nigerian government will be able to give a completely fair trial to Nnamdi Kanu? And of course, you know, what must be done also to prevent his followers from, you know, making demands and maybe, you know, creating chaos across the country?
Well, if I get your question right, are we saying that what we should expect in the new trial?
Yes, you know, how can we trust that the Nigerian government will give Nnamdi Kanu a fair trial? Is there things that you would expect this time around, looking at how it was in the past?
Well, let me say with due respect to most of our judges and most of our courts, they have always tried as much as possible that people who are arraigned before them get a fair trial. Even complicated cases like that of Evans and some other cases and all that, our courts have also always tried as much as possible to do justice. But the case of Nnamdi Kanu, in my humble opinion, is not a matter that should be decided in court. It's a political issue. It's not a matter to be decided in court. Taking him to court to decide the political issue or a political matter, man can is not likely to get justice. I suspect that they might be bringing fresh charges against him, that they have been responsible for the killing of policemen, which is a murder. He has tried suicide in Nigeria, which is a treason. He has been destroying a public property, which is a arson, and so many other egregious crimes. without us looking at what were the things that led to those things. Because you couldn't have been burning police station, killing police without certain things being responsible for it. The killings that we have seen, due respect for those who have lost their lives, with due respect to their families, with due respect to the public properties that have been burned and all that, we must never treat any of these things in isolation. Injustice will always lead to some responses. The responses might not be too palatable for the state. The way and manner the security people have also handled the challenges coming from the southeast, in a way could have precipitated the kind of crisis that we have in those places today. So we require to apply wisdom. We require to ensure that this matter is handled politically and not as a court matter. Because if you approach it as a court matter and they bring the kind of charges that I said they are handled to bring in against them, there could be a miscarriage of justice. And let me say this, and let me admonish the government. When Nelson Mandela and his brothers and sisters were agitated for independence in South Africa, and they were taken to court and convicted, nobody killed them. If the authorities in there have been behaving like the way our people here are behaving, Nelson Mandela would not have been allowed to lead the people to independence. Also go to Kenya. Also go to Kenneth Kanda did in his country. So for some of these other liberation fighters all over the world, their cases are always treated politically, and nobody arrests them in court or takes them to court with the view to convict them for murder, treason, and arson, and sending them to the gallows.
Okay, I'm still talking about being fair, you know, to Nnamdi Kanu. Are you concerned about how the DSS operatives would treat Nnamdi Kanu in prison, in their custody, you know, regarding his upkeep and welfare? Because these concerns came up when we were talking about Ibrahim El-Zakzaki of the IMN, talking about how he was being fed and how he was sick in their custody. So do you have concerns that Nnamdi Kanu will be cared for while in DSS custody?
I saw the humiliating treatment that Nnamdi Kanu was given. They put him in leg chain, they put him in handcuffs. He was also blindfolded, even when appearing before the court. That is not part and parcel of our law. When a person is put before the court, the law is that he will not be saddled with any fetters, whether handcuffs or blindfold or leg chains and what have you, and that the court's door will always remain open for people to be able to come in and out and witness whatever proceedings are going on, and at the end of the day be able to say, look, I think a fair trial is going on in here. But in the case of Nnamdi Kanu, he was abducted by the DSS and already arranged, already taken to court with him not having access to his lawyer, and then he's been put in jail and been put in blindfold and what have you. All these things are not what is expected when the person appears before the court. But more importantly, the truth of the matter is that if you have looked at the antecedents of the DSS, you will not be surprised about what they have done to Nnamdi Kanu. That organization is an irresponsible organization that should have no place under a democracy, in Nigeria. Look at what happened during the NSAF. Most of those hoodlums that you saw who were attacking the NSAF protesters and others were recruited by the DSS and set up in there to kill and maim innocent people. Also look at what happened to Adeyanju when he was agitated as Sowore should be released from the custody of the DSS. They hired talks all the way from Kano or Katuna to go and attack Adeyanju and the other protesters in front of the Nigerian Human Rights Commission office in Africa. And that young man was nearly killed in there. Good Samaritan had to provide the resources to take him to, I think, Dubai or whatever for treatment to save his life. And not too long ago, there have been instances in which the theater will go and arrest traders who are selling rice in the pattern. And even some people suspected to have participated
in the NSAF
protest. They go there in the middle of the night with hammers and guns at the middle of the night, breaking down doors, breaking down windows, and even the process, cutting away whatever money they find in these people's houses. This is not the way TSS or a secret police also behave.
All right. Mr. Kolawole, we'll have to end the conversation here. But, of course, thank you for stepping in.
Thank you.
Of course, sharing your thoughts on the situation so far. We, of course, look forward to more developments and we'll be bringing you in again. Thanks for your time this morning.
Thanks for having me.
Absolutely.
Ooh, Osawage, this seems like it's going to be one of the biggest stories for the time that this case continues to go on, even after. And what I'm really looking forward to seeing is what the impact of the British High Commission would be in this case, because, you know, like we've read in the papers this morning, they've volunteered to offer consular assistance. They said they want to begin talks with the federal government. So just how much impact would the involvement of the British government be in the case and trial of Nnamdi Kanu? That's still left to be seen.
Well, I think I understand what politics enough to also not take everything that I read, you know, from
literal,
you know, yeah, from wherever country. Hook, line, and sinker. You know, they of course will put out their own statements.
Especially since they backtracked. They had offered asylum to IPOB leaders, but then backtracked. Yeah, so yes, yeah. There's still much left to be seen.
Absolutely, they will put out their statements as expected. You know, but there's always something at play. You know, in the background that a lot of people will not be aware of.
Mm.
But we'll see. Of course, we'll be here to report everything. Thanks for staying with us. Thanks for starting the month of July with us. If you missed out on the conversations this morning, including Pa Ayo Adebanjo, you can catch up on our social media platforms at Plus TV Africa on Facebook and Instagram.
And yes, please do not forget to subscribe to our new YouTube channel. It's called at Plus TV Africa Lifestyle. I am Aneta Felix.
And I am Osawage Ogbon.